Thank God for those who are also joining us on LifeGate Outreach TV, our audiovisual channel on YouTube, and also those who will be listening to this as an audio message after now. I want to believe God that the same blessings that are upon us here in the house will surely reach you in the name of Jesus. So we thank you, and we thank you for the testimonies you send from time to time. We get testimonies from all over the world, and it's very, very impressive to hear that you are from Warsaw, able to hear us in those distant places. And we are thankful to the Lord God Almighty who has made it possible. We pray that he will continue to multiply those testimonies in your lives. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. We started a series early this month on developing kingdom traits. And it's such a wonderful opportunity and a wonderful privilege for us to look at these kingdom traits in the context of open heavens that God has promised us for this year and this season. We have been looking at these kingdom traits right from 2 weeks ago, and the theme has been taken from 2 Peter chapter 1 from verse 5 to 7. It is on that note that we have a banner this week that the Lord has given to us to be able to just explain what has been happening. It says, "But also for this reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to your virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness, to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love." Today we are looking at godliness and brotherly kindness. Now on the banner you can see I've illustrated this in the form of a ladder, which beats, because the Bible says, add to your faith. Tell your neighbor for me, add to your faith.
Add to your faith.
Say, your faith, is the basic level.
Your faith
is the first thing, is the most essential. However, add to it virtue, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, and love. Godliness is a kingdom trait that we possess as a means of demonstrating the God nature in us. We have a God nature in us. We have a seed of God in us. Godliness does not mean perfection. It is an intentional pursuit of perfection. Godliness does not mean that you are already perfect, but it means that you are engaging in a positive walk towards perfection. The Bible says, be perfect. That means perfection is your potential. Perfection is what you can become. Praise the Lord. Excellent is what you can become. Holy is what you can become. So when he says, be holy, be perfect, it says, make the intentional walk towards perfection. That's why he said, for you to get this, you must add to your faith. Your faith is like the vehicle you get inside. But it does not necessarily mean that you have reached your destination. So you add to it, you move by it towards perfection by virtue. Virtue meaning recognizing the whole essence of the power of God, the who he is, understanding him. So for you to add virtue, you also need to add knowledge. Knowledge allows you to decipher God. It allows you to break him down into rationable compartments that you can relate with. God is omnipotent. He's omniscient. He's omnipresent. And at times you need to just understand how to relate with him. And that can only come by knowledge. When Moses was sent back to Egypt to go and rescue the children of Israel, they said to him, Moses asked God, he said, who will I say to them has sent me? He said, go and tell them, I am has sent you. That is his virtue. So any way they want him to be God for them, he is God. He is. He is their healer. So I am your healer, have sent you. I am your provider, has sent you. I am your protector, has sent you. So I am just simply meant, I am God of all virtue. But you need knowledge to relate with him in aspects of life that you are embarking upon so that he manifests to you exactly the way you need him per time. And as you add to it knowledge, you also need to add self-control. Because you must understand that self-control and perseverance are the things that will help you to have a wholesome walk with him. His ways are not your ways. His timing is not your timing. You must understand that he doesn't reason the way you reason. So you must control yourself. When the flesh wants you to reason other way, you must control yourself to be able to fall in line. By his own help, by the Holy Spirit, you ask your flesh and your mind and your limited abilities and thinking to fall in line with his virtue. So this is why knowledge is also important. Same thing with perseverance. And then today we are talking about godliness. Having done all these, you now start to manifest his nature of godliness. You start to manifest. When you rub off with a person or a thing, you start to speak like that thing. You start to be like that thing. This is why at times when couples have been married after some time, when you look at their picture, you'll be wondering that why are these two people looking alike? Nothing has changed, but because some traits have rubbed into one another, it starts to even show in a way in their physical disposition. And then when they have children, that is actually physically expressed in the coming together of the two. So the Bible says, he who is joined to the Lord, he who is joined to the harlot is one spirit with the harlot. But the same way, he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. So godliness starts to manifest in you because by knowledge and by perseverance and self-control and knowledge, you have tapped into virtue as you are embarking on your walk of faith. This is what godliness is. So it leads us to a very practical awareness of God in every aspect of life. I want to say three things about godliness. There is what is called the mystery of godliness. And we need to understand how it works. Somebody say the mystery of godliness. Then there is also what is called, what I call the dynamics of godliness. We're going to talk about it. This is how godliness works, how God allows us to access it and manifest it. And then there is also the benefits of godliness. So I'll quickly tell us those three things before we look at brotherly kindness this morning. The mystery of godliness is what the scripture talks about as a special preserve for the church, for the New Testament saints, those of us who have received Jesus Christ into our lives as Lord and Savior. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. The Bible says, and without controversy, that's the first scripture I want you to write up after our text scripture today. 1 Timothy 3:16. Write it and read it with me. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen by angels, preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up in glory. Now, this is the mystery of godliness. The Bible says, without a doubt, without argument, without debate, this is a great mystery. The Old Testament people did not have it. The saints of old that we revere so much, like Daniel, Joseph, David, Jonah, Moses, Abraham, they didn't have this mystery revealed to them. They knew it was a mystery. They knew that there was something about God. God did not manifest in the flesh in the Old Testament. He spoke to them. He manifested by fire. He manifested by water. He manifested, he spoke his word. So many ways he appeared to them, thunders and lightnings and so on and so forth. So they kept on worshiping this God who had packaged a mystery of his godliness even to them at that point. But the Bible, when Paul began to speak to Timothy, Timothy was a disciple of Paul, who was of both Jewish and the Gentile descent. And so Timothy was one of the most trusted allies and disciples of Paul. Paul respected Timothy so much, even though he was much younger than him. He saw Timothy as a gateway into the Jewish world and the Gentile world very well. He was sent to the Gentiles. Paul was sent to the Gentiles. The Jews did not want him because he used to persecute them. But by the reason of his connection with Timothy, he had an inroad that was excellent. And so Paul really charged, most of the scriptures we're going to be reading today are from Timothy. Paul charged Timothy among the things. He said, learn this mystery and teach it to others. He said, great is this mystery of godliness. He said, God was manifested in the flesh. John chapter 1 verse 14, write it down. The Bible says, and God became flesh, and the word became flesh, and he dwells amongst us. So talking about the coming of Jesus Christ in the flesh. The Bible says he was justified in the spirit. At his baptism, we were told in Luke chapter 4 and Mark chapter 4, we were told that as he came up out of the water, the Holy Spirit descended upon him as a dove, and a voice came from heaven and said, this is my beloved son. Hear ye him, or in whom I am well pleased, which simply means he was justified in the spirit. And the Bible says he was seen by angels. We know severally that angels ministered to Jesus Christ, particularly when he was tempted by the enemy. After Satan left him, the Bible says angels came and they ministered to him. He was preached on among the Gentiles. We were told that everywhere they went, they were saying to the people, John the Baptist started to say, prepare the way for the one who is coming. And he said, I'm not worthy to untie his shoe latchets, but he is coming and he is going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, even though I'm just baptizing you now with water. He was preached on among the Gentiles. Peter later came and said in Acts chapter 4 verse 12, he said, neither is there salvation in any other name except the name Jesus Christ, whereby we must be saved. And the Bible says also he was believed on in the world. The mystery of godliness is that Jesus came in the flesh. He was justified in the spirit. He was seen of angels. He was preached on among the Gentiles. He was believed on in the world. And the Bible says in John chapter 1 verse 12, write it down. John chapter 1 verse 12, he said, as many that received him, as many that believed him, he gave them power to be called the sons of God. And then he was received up into glory. We were told in Acts chapter 1, as he rose up into heaven, the disciples were looking at him, and the angel came and said to them, he said, ye men of Galilee, why are you looking up into heaven? This same Jesus whom you see taken away from you today will soon return the same way you have seen him go. He was received up into glory. But you know, everything that happened in the life of Jesus, part of the mystery of godliness is that it is also our portion. I say it is also your portion. You are also born in the flesh. That is why you can see me, I can see you. We are also born in the flesh. We are also justified in the spirit. Write it down, Romans chapter 8, verse 28 to verse 30. The Bible says that God justified us. Him whom he foreknew, he called. Them whom he called, he justified. Tell your neighbor for me, you are also justified in the spirit. So we are also justified. We are also seen by angels. The Bible tells us in Psalm 91, he said that he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I will trust. Surely he will deliver me. Surely he will not let me bash my feet against the stones. He said he will cause his angels to bear me up in their arms. You are also seen by angels. Hallelujah. You and I are to be believed on. We are also to be preached among the Gentiles. How? Because the Bible says that we are the light of the world. Matthew chapter 5 verse 14. Write it down. It says, you are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. You are a city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. So you are also preached among the Gentiles. Your life is a message and should be a message. This is the mystery of godliness. And you will also be believed on in the world. The Bible says that as we speak, we believe. As we speak, we believe. When our lives speak it draws men unto him. He said, when we lift him up before men, he will draw all men unto himself. And ultimately, we will be received up in glory. Hallelujah. I said, we will be received up in glory. Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, he said, the same way Jesus will appear with a sound and with a shout. He said, and in an instant, we shall be caught up in the air with him to be received up in glory. So the mystery of godliness is not just about us living a life that is, in quote, godly. Even though that is what it is, but it goes beyond that simple literal explanation. It is about a partnership with God who manifested in the flesh. It is about living the example of the God who came and was justified in the spirit, seen by angels, preached on in the world, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. This is what God wants us to be. We are benefactors of this revelation, of this mystery, as members of the body of Christ. It is a very new covenant privilege. Colossians chapter 1, verse 26 and 27. Write it down. The Bible says the mystery that once was hidden from ages and generation, but has now been revealed unto us, the saints. He said, that mystery is Christ in you. Look at your neighbor for me. Say, that mystery is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in me, the hope of glory. This is what the mystery is. So the mystery of godliness is what we must understand. And in the same way, it helps us also to go and now understand the dynamics of godliness. I want every member of this church to confidently be able to say and defend their faith. A lot of believers do not even know how to defend their faith. Now, if you cannot defend your faith, how can you represent the one who called you? I have never seen an ambassador who gives his letter of credence to a head of state of the country he has been sent. And then they ask him, they say, Your Excellency, what do you think will be your role in this place? What do you have to say about your country? Say, my country? I'm actually not sure. Let me pick the phone to ask my boss what our country is all about. He will start to reel out the positive. No ambassador talks about the bad side of his country. Have you ever seen an ambassador stand before people and say, you know, I come from the worst country on earth. We don't have food, we don't have light, we don't have water. Even countries that don't have those things, when their ambassadors speak, they say, we're a giant nation. We're moving towards perfection. We're working very hard on all our issues. Hallelujah. So Christians must not belittle God. When we go before people and we cannot fully defend our faith, we are belittling the kingdom that we represent. This is the mystery of godliness. David did not carry Jesus, as respectable as King David was. He did not have Jesus in his heart. Abraham did not have Jesus in his heart. They only heard the word of God from outside. We have him on our inside. He said, it is Christ in us, the hope of glory. When this settles for you, you will understand why you must live your life differently. You are no ordinary person. The Bible says, let that mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus. That's the potential of what you have as a person who operates by the mystery of godliness. The first thing we must understand by the dynamics of godliness is that we must rely on grace for godliness. It's all a work of grace. Titus chapter 2, verse 11 to 14. For the grace of God, read it with me. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, that is to say, these are the things that we must reject. These are the things that are naturally freely given to us by the devil in the system we belong. But we must receive the grace of God to deny these things. It appears to us to deny them. Then we should also receive that grace. Let's continue reading. To live soberly, righteously, and godly. Please go back to it, sir. To live soberly, righteously, and godly. When? In this present age. So if anybody tells you that grace is all about receiving grace and to live anyhow, they are heretic. They are preaching a false doctrine that is not from God, but has come from the pit of hell. The Bible says that grace teaches us to say no or to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. And it also teaches us that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly. Hallelujah. In this present age. So the dynamics of godliness is that we must embrace grace. On a daily basis, you restock for grace. You go before the Lord and say, Lord, I receive your grace today to live soberly, to live righteously, and to live godly. When you receive that grace, it helps you to persevere. It helps you to be in self-control. It helps you to have knowledge to the things that you need to keep drawing from the virtue that God gives so that your faith can be potent and your faith can deliver good works. Verse 13. He said, looking for what? The blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. Verse 14. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed. Tell your neighbor for me, you have been redeemed. Say, you are not going to be redeemed. You have already been redeemed. If your neighbor is not talking to you, ask them, why are you not talking to me? Say, you have been redeemed from every lawless deed. You are not going to be redeemed, but you have been redeemed already by Jesus Christ himself. He said he might redeem us from, he gave himself that he might. So the might there means when he gave himself, not that he will still do it later. That he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself. This is why I said to you that the mystery of godliness is that all of us will still be caught up in the air with him. His desire is that we be caught up with him. He said that he might purify for himself his own special people. Read the last phrase for me. Zealous for what? Good works. Zealous for good works. Desirous of serving God. Desirous of doing good. Desirous of fellowship. Desirous of loving. Desirous of doing right. Desirous of praying. Desirous of studying about God. Desirous of every good work being a blessing to others. This is their zeal. This is the dynamics of godliness. When we receive grace, we become a people zealous for good works. I say you will be that people today. In this church, we will be people zealous for good works. In the name of Jesus. Nobody, I've said it to you over and over again. Nobody is saved by works, but salvation is maintained by everybody by good works. The Bible says we must work out our salvation. Acts chapter 14, verse 22. We must work out our salvation with fear and trembling. We must work it out. Those of you that everybody that has done mathematics here at whatever level, even from primary school, when they give you a sum and they say, solve this problem, do you just say, this is the answer? You don't say, this is the answer. You work it out. You work it out and you start to go step one, step two, step three. And at times, because you have even done the right steps, even if the answer is wrong, they give you marks for doing the right steps. Maybe the last point, you did something funny. You put a decimal point somewhere else. And then they just pity you, take off a little mark. But you will still pass it because they saw the steps that you took. That is how to work out your salvation. You wake up every day meticulously working it out. This is not living legalistically. This is not just taking a set of rules and do's and don'ts. This is not what we're talking about. But this is an intentional walk, not to be an angry person, not to be a bitter person, not to be an adulterer, not to be a fornicator, not to be a liar. You decide. It is not a gift. The natural man wants to sin. He wants to lie. He wants to fornicate. He wants to do bad. The natural man is evil. So you work out your salvation by grace. You keep tapping into the grace of God. That Lord, today I receive the grace to deny ungodliness, to deny worldliness, to deny everything that the enemy is using against my life, my spiritual life. I receive the grace from on high. And then you begin to receive the grace to do good works. I pray that that grace will come upon you. In the name of Jesus. Friends, there is nobody on earth that does not need the grace for good works. The second thing in the dynamics of godliness is that we need to pray and be humble for godliness to prevail in our lives. I said we need grace, but the way, part of why, how we can tap into grace is by simply praying. The Bible says he gives grace to the humble. So we must pray and we must be humble. One of the things Paul said to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 2, we've read it earlier on today, verse 1. He says, therefore, verse 1, 1 Timothy 2, write it down, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, I exhort first of all that supplications, somebody say supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. Please stop there. Somebody say supplications. Now, last year, at a point, we were trying to look at the different forms of prayer, if you remember. And I said, anytime you see the word supplication, it talks about a cry to God for help. Many believers are so proud and arrogant, even when they know that they need to cry to God for help in certain areas, they don't bother. Because they feel, what will somebody say if they know that I'm struggling in this area? What will they think? Is it what somebody thinks about you that matters or what God thinks? You need to ask yourself every day. So you go before your God in supplication. You cry out to him. Hannah went by supplication. He said, Lord, give me this man child. Help me to have this child. And at times she was praying to the point where what she was saying were no more audible words. And it looked as if she was drunk. That is what supplication is. You don't just cry out to God to bless you with a new house, a new clothes, a new car, a new job. Those things are the children's right. You need to cry to God for godliness. There is a war. There is a war. There is a battle for your soul. The devil does not want you and I to be godly. The devil does not want anybody to be a success at Christianity. He doesn't want you to be a true disciple who is fruitful. So he works against you day and night. The Bible says he is going about day and night, seeking whom he might devour. He's roaring like, he's going about as a roaring lion, going to and fro. You must go by supplication. Prayers, there mean all kinds of prayers. Praying in the spirit, praying in understanding, just praying and asking God to help you. And then intercessions. Intercession simply means praying for somebody else. I am praying for you, you are praying for me. There is no day on earth that passes. It's impossible. For over 2.5 years now that I have not opened my mouth to pray for everyone here. In fact, I pray for those that are yet to come. I always pray with the pastors. We pray current and potential. Because everybody that is meant to be in this fold is somebody that needs our intercession. If you pray for me, I pray for you. We pray for each other every time. We draw the grace. The Bible says that we should pray that giving of all thanks be made for all men. The word men there, anytime you see the word men and women in scripture, you need to understand the context. The word men there is not just talking about the men folk. It's talking about that man, Adam, in Genesis chapter 2, before he slept. The one that was looked at and was said, male and female created he them. The complete man, the man that was all in one, that God described as being alone. So when he says for all men, it means for everyone. We must understand that. And so he said we must be giving thanks for every man. Please go to verse 2. Verse 2. He said for kings and all who are in authority. How many of us have ever used this scripture to pray for governors and mayors and prime ministers and presidents? I'm sure you've done that before. Let me see your hand. You've used it. Yes. Fantastic. It is true. That is what it means. But you know something? Look at your neighbor for me. Tell them for me that you are also a king. Don't say you are a queen. Tell them you are also a king. Tell them that you are also a king. Tell them that you also have authority. 1 Peter 2:9 says you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are a peculiar people. You are being called to show forth his praises. So you are also kings. And the Bible says in Luke 10:19, write it down, Luke 10:19. He said, I have given you authority. Jesus speaking. He said, I have given you authority to trample on snakes and serpents and scorpions. And nothing shall by any means, and over the works of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. That's Luke chapter 10, verse 19. You and I must understand that We must be praying for ourselves and for one another. He said, for kings and all those who are in authority. That why? Why should we pray? Let's read it together. That we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all goodness and reverence. In all godliness. In all godliness and reverence. You will lead a quiet life. I say you will lead a quiet life. All this noise in your heart that doesn't allow you to settle and think straight. My God will cause you to lead a quiet life. In the name of Jesus. You need to be able to close your eyes and sleep soundly. That is the gift of sleep. When you sleep and it looks like you are in a battle in Syria or Iraq or in parts of Libya where there is gunshots every time, it is not of God. And I pray today that my God will deliver you from that torment. In the name of Jesus. He said you may lead a quiet and peaceable life. The peace of God will be restored to your life. I said the peace of God will be restored to your life. It will be restored to your marriage. It will be restored to your job. In the name of Jesus. This is how he wants us to lead. So that in all things, we can have all godliness and reverence. When your life is at peace, it's so easy to be godly. It's so easy. Most people are irrational and brute and crude because there is no peace in their inner man. Most people are very tough on others. Where you see a boss that comes in every day and starts shouting on everybody from A to Z, plus the people doing the work and the ones not doing, he's just talking and go and check. There's no peace in his family. If he's coming from a place where he has just said, bye, honey, and he's just had all the loving touch of a good spouse, when he gets to the office, you will see that he will also be jolly, jolly to everybody because there is peace where he's coming from. God wants you to lead quiet and peaceable life. It helps you to be godly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we need to pray so that to be godly. The second part of that is we need to be humble. Humility. The Bible says, James chapter 4, verse 7, it said, God gives grace to the humble. God gives grace to the humble. But let's quickly look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8. He said, I desire therefore that men, again, pray everywhere, lifting up what? Holy hands, without wrath and doubting. Many men today, many godly men lift up holy hands, in quote, but is full of wrath and doubting. That makes the hands unholy. Joyce Meyer said, oh, God helped her for through many years. It's all over her messages. You will always hear them if you listen to her. It's a fantastic woman of God, that one, 40 years almost in ministry. She says many times she used to come to church those days, she would lift up her two hands. And they sing songs like, I surrender. And she'll be telling herself in her mind, looking at her husband, say, if you think I'll cook for you today, you are wasting your time. I surrender. I told you not to play golf last night. You went away. You are coming back this morning. You are telling me not to say, unto thee, my blessed Savior. I can't do it as good as she does it. You just need to hear it yourself. Wonderful stuff. So this is exactly how it is. We may laugh at Joyce Meyer today, but she was just being honest. But there are so many people today in church lifting up so-called holy hands, but so much wrath and so much doubting in the heart. They are singing songs, Lord, I come to you, I believe in you. But right there in their heart, there is a doubt. How can it be? I'm not sure this can ever be. Truly, Lord, do you love me? Why am I suffering this? Why am I suffering that? Asking more questions in their heart than they should give praise to God. We must not let these kind of things happen to us because they defy our godliness. Godliness simply means that we lift up hands in submission. In verse 9, he said, in like manner also that women adorn themselves in modest apparel. This is one of the most the most misinterpreted scriptures in the Word of God. He said that women adorn themselves in modest apparel with propriety and moderation, not with braided hair. Are you in verse 9, sir? Not with braided hair or gold or pearls or costly clothing, verse 10, but which is proper for women professing godliness with what? With good works. Go back to verse 9. Many people have read verse 9 and have taken that to literally mean that it means that women must look like people from the 18th century because that is modest apparel. And they must not braid their hair. They must not wear any gold. And they must not dress in any costly clothing. So they specifically go to charity shops and where they sell very, very cheap clothing or not sell at all and put it on because they want to be women who adorn themselves in modest apparel. That is a misinterpretation of the entire scripture. What he's simply saying is that don't let your godliness be as a result of what you put on. By all means, please look nice, dress well, wear everything that represents your God in the most appropriate way. So you represent him well. It has nothing to do with what you wear, but you must understand that the godliness is not based on those things. Unfortunately, the church of today, in wanting to represent God well, we have gone back to the same place where Paul was warning Timothy to tell people. A lot of people have shifted godliness to those outward things. We must find the balance. Look well, look decent. It helps you to get your message across. There is nobody that looks good. We were having a joke yesterday. We had cause to be at the airport with some of our brothers here, some of our brethren here, and we're coming back, and we were having a discussion, and somebody just made a comment. He said, do you know that it's even funny when somebody just dresses very nicely and they just sit down in a first-class cabin in a train, that at times nobody even talks to them because they just assume that because of the way they are dressed, they have the right ticket. Do you know that that is true? Now, I'm not saying you should go and do that. I beg of you. If they catch you and you say, it's my pastor. It's my pastor. If my pastor said so, he said I should wear my best suit and sit in first class. Virgin Train will catch you and find you £1,000. Don't call me. Don't call me. No, but on a serious note, when you present yourself very well, you tend to have acceptance. Praise the Lord. I'm not saying costly clothing. I'm only saying present yourself well. It helps you to let that God that is in you. People see what you put on first before they listen to what you have on your inside. If I appear here like somebody who is just coming from okay. Praise the Lord. You need to just present yourself well. The scripture here is saying that don't get bogged down. He used the women folk because we must understand that it is very, women use more of those things. They use more of gold. They use more of the trinkets. They do the hair. They do the things. They wear the gold. He said, whilst all that is okay, let it be in moderation, which means that don't put efforts in putting those things on as a mark of your godliness. Put more effort in working on the inner man, so that whatever you put on the outside will now be as beautiful, hallelujah, as what is on the inside. It is a torment to have a good-looking woman. Every man will tell you, you might have a very beautiful woman looking radiant every time, but if she's a torment from the inside, it is a worse person to be with. You prefer to have one that doesn't look like anything, but has a good-natured person on her inside. This is the same way we all must understand, not just as women, that how we package ourselves. Godliness must come from within rather than what we are trying to do on the outside. Men, godliness has nothing to do with what is in your bank account or the kind of car you drive. Men are so very passionate about those things. We must understand that those things don't give you any identity. You're real, whilst it's good to go for the best things in life and God will give you the best things, I say God will give you the best things. If God does not want best things for his people, he will not have given them gold and silver and those wonderful things when they were living in Egypt. So we know that God wants good things for his children. No doubt about that. But much more, he will say, let them go. Did he say that release my people that they go and wear good things? He said that they should go and they serve me. Let them go that they may worship me. Let them go that they may serve me. And the Bible says they that must worship God in spirit and in truth, not in good suits and good clothing. So let's get the balance very right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Godliness, the third thing about the dynamics of godliness, godliness must go with contentment. Godliness must go. Say with me, godliness must go with contentment. 1 Timothy chapter 6 from verse 6. Now, godliness with contentment is what? Great gain. Verse 7. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain. Somebody say it is certain. We can carry nothing out. You need to understand that life is in phases. There are certain things you can't do now. Don't kill yourself over it. It can rob you of godliness. There are certain things you can't do. You look at some people, the way they do some things, and they just do it, and you just say, Lord, why is my own like this? And then you go and force yourself to do the same thing. You waste your time. You waste your time. There was a time I was flying in and out of this country to my home country 3 times a year. And somebody said, this guy, you seem to have made a lot of money. Why are you flying? I said, "You don't know. I wasn't the one paying for all those trips. They never knew. Somebody else was paying. An organization was paying regularly. But you see, because it was my home country, and I was going back there and out, and it just naturally looked as if this guy must have hit. And at times, I even fly business class, you see. But you see, somebody looking from outside will not understand. He thinks this guy has made so much money. He doesn't know that the person, there is something else completely arranging to it by God. Godliness with contentment is great gain, is great profit. We bought nothing into this world, and certain we will not take anything out of it. He said, when we have food and clothing, with these we should be content. Whatever you have before you, bless it and say, Lord, I thank you. Whether it is a pot of pot noodles or caviar, it means nothing. It's just food. So whatever God puts before you, say, Lord, I thank you. I receive this food with thanksgiving. Don't be worried that, Lord, how is it that those people who eat these nice, costly things, why, how do they do their lives? And why is my life like this? After all, I'm serving you. You will lose your godliness on the platform of lack of contentment. Contentment is not the same thing with complacency, I have always said. Complacency means you do not desire any increase, you don't even care. That is not what we're talking about. The Bible says the path of a just man is as a shining light that shines brighter and brighter. You work hard, you trust God to move up in life, but you are contented with wherever you are. Be happy with who you are. Tell your neighbor for me, be happy with who you are. Be grateful for everything God has given you. There is nobody on earth that has not received something from God. That you have breath on your inside means that you have something from God. And the Lord will continue to perfect everything that concerns you. In the name of Jesus. Go straight to verse 11. He said, but you, O man, flee these things and pursue righteousness. Verse 10 had said, for the love of money is the root of all evil. The love of money, not money, is the root of evil. I've heard people say, because the Bible says money is the root of all evil. The Bible never said money is the root of all evil. He said the love of money is the root of all evil. He said, for which some have strayed from the faith. Friends, the world that we live in is very pressurizing. I want to say this very carefully. To maintain your godliness, you must put on your thinking cap. Otherwise, you just walk and walk and walk and walk and walk and walk because money is demanded. Now, I am saying this very cautiously. We have to pay bills. We have to live life. And I know that. But I want you to understand that if you can lock in with the principle of seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, you suddenly find that in all labor that you have, there is profit indeed. I said there will be profit indeed. In the name of Jesus, you will not stray from the faith. You will not stray from the faith. Because you will not love money. I say you will not love money. Why are you afraid to say amen? You want to love money? You want to love money? I say you will not love money. In the name of Jesus. But you will be blessed with money. Abundance of it. It will pursue you. I say it will pursue you. As you pursue God. As you pursue God. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Friends, if we want the blessing, let's go for the blessor. The final thing I want to say on godliness, we have not got to brotherly kindness, God help me. The final thing I want to say on godliness is that we must overcome the spirit of the end time. There is a spirit of the end time. It manifests in different ways. Paul spoke to Timothy about it in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Let's read it very quickly. Write it down. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 to verse 3. He says, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to what? Deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. They will be forbidden to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth." Now, he was speaking particularly to these people, and there was a particular culture that was prevalent in that time where people did not want to marry as a demand on some of the gods that they were serving then. And there was also the fact that they were asking them not to eat certain foods. Paul said that that is the doctrine of demons. They are deceiving spirits. We have it manifesting in different forms in our world today. It is so difficult to watch even Christian TV. I say this with all sense of humility and without any kind of regret in terms of what I'm saying. But it's so sad that we cannot watch Christian TV confidently anymore. Because at times the kind of message you hear somebody speak is so completely anti-scripture. There is no scripture that commands you to do anything whatsoever in order to be able to please a human being, in order for God to hear you. There is no scripture, any scripture that says you must do something for any human being so that God can hear your prayer. Anybody that says that is heretic. They are seducing spirits. They are speaking lies in hypocrisy. These are people craving for men worship and not knowing it. Every man of God must learn how to point people to God. It does not end with you. You are only a mouthpiece. You are meant to lead the people to God, not to yourself. Any doctrine that is forcing a church to just simply stay with the ideologies of a human being is a doctrine from the pit of hell. Everything that must be preached from this altar by the special grace of God will be as read from scripture to your very ears and as granted us understanding by the Holy Spirit. I say, so shall it be. In the name of Jesus, there is a spirit of the end time. We must not be carried away by it. Paul spoke about it again in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 to verse 7. These are things robbing people of godliness and making them ungodly. Verse 1, he said, "But know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. Men will be lovers of themselves." Somebody say, "I reject it." Lovers of money. Somebody say, "I reject it." Boasters. Somebody say, "I reject it." Proud. Blasphemers. Somebody say, "I reject it." Disobedient to parents. Somebody say, "I reject it." Unthankful. Somebody say, "I reject it." Unholy. Somebody say, "I reject it." Unloving. Unforgiving. Somebody say, "I reject it." Slanderous. Somebody say, "I reject it." Without self-control. Brutal. Despisers of good. Somebody say, "I reject it." Traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Somebody say, "I reject it." Let's read verse 5 together very powerfully. Having a form of godliness but denying its power. He said, from such people, turn away. You've got to be careful. Your life is more precious. You have to watch your association. Everything that has a form of godliness that looks like it, but is denying its power, it's denying the demands of its power, is not of God. Praise the Lord. We have many people who are disobedient to parents, especially in our Western culture. Parents have become mates. What did you say, mate? Your father spoke to you? Your father spoke to you? And he says, what are you talking about, mate? He's not your mate. He's your father. Somebody say, father.
Father.
When you are with your friends, those are your mates. When your father is talking to you, he's not your mate. I don't care whether it's English language or Spanish. He's not your mate. We must understand. He said they will be disobedient to parents. It's a spirit of the end time. We must not allow it in the name of modernization. I'm not asking you to be rash with your children, but let children understand. I am father. This is mother. Our word under God is law. Our words under God is law. You are a child, you are meant to be taken care of. So that you can take care of us later on. The Bible says, train up a child the way he should go. And when he grows, he will not depart from it. So if you take care of them, they take care of you later on. It's a good way. Bishop Jake said, I cleaned your bum, I wiped your bum when you were young. You spat on me when I gave you food in the court. You spewed at me at 3 months. Now when I'm 90, you don't want to wipe my bum, you must wipe my bum. I said, Bishop, this is a hard one. I said, this is a hard one, but it's just truth. Hallelujah. The benefits of godliness. We must understand godliness has rewards. Godliness has rewards. It is profitable. We have heard it many times. It said godliness. 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 8. Write that down. For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things. Having a promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. Say, godliness is profitable. For all things. Godliness is profitable. For all things. So this godliness is not something that we should just have for the sake of it. There is profit by it. Amen. Psalm 5 verse 12. Say, for you, O Lord, will bless the righteous. I said, the Lord will bless you. Say, with favor, you shall surround him as with a shield. So favor is the benefit of godliness. Favor is a benefit of godliness. You find that doors open for you. I said doors will open for you. As a godly person, God will work on your behalf. Joseph was a godly man and favor was his portion all through. His father favored him. Even when his brothers betrayed him, he got to the palace. He got to Potiphar's house. Potiphar favored him again, made him the chief servant. Even when they lied against him, Potiphar's wife lied against him, they took him to prison. Favor worked for him again, and he was made the head of all the prisoners. Favor will continue to work for you. And favor eventually brought him to the very throne that God has said he will occupy. Favor will take you to your throne. As you serve God in godliness, favor will take you to your throne. In the name of Jesus. Read Genesis chapter 9, chapter 39 for Joseph's story. Daniel chapter 1 verses 8 and 9 tells us also that God favored Daniel and his brothers among all the people that came into Babylonian captivity. You need favor. Godliness delivers favor to you. I say he shall deliver favor to you. In the name of Jesus. Godliness is a choice. When we choose it, we embrace the favor of God. You will embrace his favor. In the name of Jesus. Godliness also gives us divine health and divine protection. Divine health and divine protection. Psalm 34 verse 11. It said, come, you children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Who is a man who desires life and loves many days that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil. Tell your neighbor for me. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. God wants you to serve him. God wants you to serve him. When you serve him, his eyes will be on you. I say his eyes will be on you. Go straight to verse 18. He said, the Lord is near to those who have a broken heart, those who are humble, and save such who are of a contrite spirit, a broken spirit, a spirit that is willing to yield. A spirit that is willing to reverence God. Verse 19. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. The Lord will keep delivering you out of them all. In the name of Jesus. The Lord will guard all your bones. I said the Lord will guard all your bones. That's verse 20. None of them will be broken. I say none of them will be broken. In the mighty name of Jesus. I will have to quickly talk on brotherly kindness. I know time is fast spent, but I thank you for your patience today. Please note these points down. Brotherly kindness is a special love that we have for people who are of the family of God. There are many ways we need to understand how it works. But we must have love one for another as a family of God. The first thing we need to know about brotherly kindness is that it comes by the power of the Holy Spirit. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9. It said, but concerning brotherly love, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves are taught by God to what? To love one another. Romans 5, 5 tells us that the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts. We must understand that it's the Holy Spirit that helps us to love one another. Amen. So we need to rely on the Holy Spirit in order to demonstrate brotherly love. Brotherly love, second thing, is an expression of a lifestyle of godliness. We've been talking about godliness, but part of how we show our life of godliness is by living a lifestyle of brotherly love. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. It says, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. Love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. So we must understand that as obedient children, an evidence that we have godliness working in us is that we love our brothers and our sisters. We must understand that this is not a choice. It is commanded. When we come to church, it gives us an opportunity and a platform to exhibit and demonstrate brotherly love one for another. Let's not just pick our bags and run away. I've heard the word. I've done. I'm gone. Let's remember there are people around us. Let's talk with one another. Let's encourage one another. Brotherly kindness must be pure and preferring. Romans chapter 12, verse 9. It says, let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. Verse 10, say with me, be kindly affectionate. Say, be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love. In honor, giving preference to one another. If we obey these principles amongst ourselves, even in our marriages, we will find that when you give honor to the other person and the other person gives honor to you, when you are kindly affectionate with brotherly love with your brothers around you, you will always find that we have and create a holistic environment where we allow the Holy Spirit to work. We should not let the attractiveness or human charisma of people determine how we manifest brotherly love to them. Don't look at people and say, I can love this one, I can't love this one, I can love this one, I can love that one, I can't love that. And you become like a robot, judging that one. Everybody must be loved. Whoever you are, hallelujah. However you are, everybody is created by God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Everybody is valued to God. You are worth who you are. God made you, fashioned you from the foundation of the earth. The same way he fashioned your brother, love them equally. Love your sister equally. Don't choose the people that you want to love because there is an inward righteousness in them. The peace of God is in them. And as you love them, that same righteousness, that same peace will be shared with you and your life will continue to demonstrate the goodness of God in the name of Jesus. Finally, brotherly kindness is expressed in spirituality, not in carnality. Galatians chapter 5, verse 24. It said, and those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. If we say that we are spiritual people, let us walk in the Spirit. We cannot say we are living in the Spirit and then only walking in carnality, going about talking and doing things like carnal people, people without the fear of God. Verse 26 says, let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. This is not God's intention. The body of Christ must be a solid entity where people love genuinely and sincerely. If people cannot find genuine love in church, where else on earth can they find it? People get high cheeks all over the place, in their workplace, in the supermarket. Have you met somebody in the supermarket? You just clashed at an aisle. You're about to carry the milk. They also want to carry it. And then they look at you and they give you the high cheek. That's not love. That is just to say, get out of my way, I want to get the milk as well. People get high cheeks and all kinds of things everywhere. People get false love. People get all kinds of things outside. The church should be a place where brotherly kindness is real and genuine, and people really feel like part of a body. Let us work together, and the Lord will bless us. The final scripture I want to leave with you is Hebrews chapter 13, verse 1. It says, let brotherly love continue. Let brotherly love continue.